Hey, ladies and gentlemen, welcome.
Good, that got recorded. Ladies and gentlemen, like he said, Ryan Kurzak welcomes you to my interview with him. This is why, the reason why I went to interview Ryan was, first of all, I just like him. He's a cool guy and something about him is easy to get along with. But specifically, Ryan, what I really like about you is when you talk, it makes sense.
Even if, like everybody.
Really? I don't know. To the people to whom it doesn't make sense, they probably don't have that much of a sense maker in there. Yeah, unfortunately, that doesn't happen that often, especially in the field of astrology, that when somebody talks, it actually makes sense. So I feel like you're a rational, logical person. And I like that a lot. And also, I think that the way you apply that rational logic to the astrology that you've practiced, what I've seen of it, is appealing and sensible and everything like it. So I wanted to, we've done an interview a long time ago. Mm-hmm. And it's been too long, I think. So I figured I'd take you back in and ask you these same questions that I've been asking everybody else.
Okay.
What do you think?
Sounds great.
You ready for it?
Yes.
All right. So the first thing we want to know is that astrology deals with something about fate or something about destiny or something about karma. Mm-hmm. What is that subject? What is fate, destiny, karma? Is it antithetical to free will or is it somehow integrated with free will?
Right. Well, it's a good question. And one of my students recently asked me this too, because I kept using the term karma when I'm trying to define something astrologically. When I was talking about the avashtas or planetary states, I would say these states qualify or quantify karma. And she said, you know, what exactly are you talking about when you use the term karma? And, you know, I try to get into the typical explanation that karma comes from the root word kriya and action and all this. But really, my experience in karma directly is simply whatever can be experienced. So when I'm talking about a particular bhava yoga, you know, the third lord in the fifth house or whatever it might be, or fifth lord in the seventh house, that indicates something. And anything that we can experience, see, touch, think about, feel, these are all karmas because they're all related to the idea of experience. And when I think about the idea of free will, it's really easy to fall into a state of fatalism with astrology. And I think that's a shame because if you think about it, if we take away free will in astrology or in life itself, and we're saying that if only we had the perfect astrological science, we could predict everything perfectly every time. If we say that, essentially all we're doing is staying with a Newtonian model of the universe where everything is just a big clock and it's all mechanical and there's no, you know, love, there's no creativity, there's no beauty, there's no freedom in it. And what I see with astrology all the time is that the chart represents karmas in the sense of possibilities and trends. And when we come into this life, we have this sort of imprint, this stamp that says, maybe you're going to be this kind of a person, you're going to act this way, you may have these kinds of experiences. But what we do with them, how we act with them, that tells us how it's going to develop. So I like one of the examples you gave in your book, the Beautifully Rational. It's a long, what's the name of that one?
The Beautifully Rational Philosophy of Astrology.
Right, The Beautifully Rational Philosophy of Astrology. One of the things I loved about that book was how you described, I believe you used the idea of a baseball or throwing a ball.
Right.
And when you throw the ball, it's got a certain trajectory, a certain velocity, a certain vector. It's going to go in a certain direction. And that's like the birth chart. That's showing which way has the ball been thrown. However, once it's left the person's hand, you know, once the person's been born, well, maybe a gust of wind's going to come through. Maybe it's going to hit a bird. Maybe someone's going to run and jump and catch it. All these things can occur from the time it's launched until it finally gets to where we think it's going to land. So it may land where we expect it to, but based on all these other factors that can come into play, well, who knows what's going to happen? So when it comes to astrology and karma and fate and free will, I think it's more important to realize that every thought, every action, every tendency, every emotion is a karma. And we can see those probabilities within a birth chart. But if we're, unless we're completely on autopilot, there is room to make changes. Because if you think about it, why on earth would we have astrology in the first place if everything was already predestined? Because why would you need it? Why would it even matter? Why would you need to just go pay someone to tell you something that's already going to happen anyway? Why not just wait and see what's going to happen and be okay with it? Now, I think that's a very high form of spirituality, and I think that's very good. But it's not necessarily, you know, how most people function. So the astrologer's role is to show this is the path that's happening. This is the probable path based on the karmas that you've put into motion in the past. But if you can start thinking in any way, shape, or form, start choosing new behaviors, there's a greater likelihood that maybe that doesn't necessarily have to happen that way, or maybe you can work with it in a different fashion. That's why it's always so hard to look at someone's chart and people say things like, well, gee, I don't know whether you're a highly realized spiritual person or a complete drug addict. Well, right. What's going to make the difference there? I know we've talked about before. What's going to make the difference there? It's going to be the person's choices. But does this answer some of the questions that you're curious about?
Yeah. So let me ask you a question. But when you look at a chart, mm-hmm. can you differentiate between this is an easy thing for the person to change versus this is so deeply ingrained in the person's habitual subconsciousness that it's going to be next to impossible for them to change this?
Yeah, I think that's a good point. And that's, that goes into the different kinds of karma. I don't really want to get into the levels of karma, but the way we think about it is, the more often something shows up in a chart, the more times we see this person is going to have great communication skills, good skills in business, good people skills, the more we see that come up in a chart, the more we can get a sense that it's going to be more likely for them to be that way. You know, it's like if every day I go and I play my mandolin and my guitar, well, that's going to reinforce my capacity to be able to do that. So I know that tomorrow, if someone says, hey, can you play this song? Well, I'm going to be able to do it. I'm not going to think about it. I'm not going to worry about it. It's not going to be something that's going to be a maybe. It's going to be, well, yeah, I've done this for the past, 30 some years, so I can do it again tomorrow. And so when you see something in a chart that's a maybe, that's not supported by four or five other factors, it's a possibility. It's something someone can build upon, but it's not necessarily going to be something that is a given. And that also goes into different things like the Baladi Avashtas, where we're thinking about whether a planet's at the beginning of a sign or the middle of a sign or an end of a sign. You know, I often use like the Bala Avashta when it's in an infant state, as though that's showing a karma that's just beginning to develop. So It's got a certain amount of power, but it's got the power of, say, a child or an infant, but it's developing. Whereas if we have a planet that's right in the middle of a sign, say 15 degrees, 14 degrees, well, that's always going to be typically in a Yuva Avashta or an adult state, which shows us that it's going to be a karma that's in your face. It's there, it's fully formed, it's fully functional, it's happening right now. So if we see someone who has a disease karma and it's in a Mritya Avashta or it's in a Bala Avashta, well, we're going to see, on one hand, it's going to be a karma that's developing. So if it's a disease-related karma, we can say, all right, this is starting to come into your awareness. It's a karma that maybe you started in past lifetimes that's coming in again. But since it's an infant, you have a greater sense, a greater power to work with it, to kind of cut it off before it turns into an adult state. Mm. Whereas if I see a karma for disease and illness that's in an adult state, I can say, look, this is going to be something that you have to work really hard to prevent from happening in your life, because it's already a fully developed, fully functional karma. So you have to be cautious of it. So there are different ways to see that. But I think overall, it's how often do you see it? And this is also where a lot of astrologers make mistakes. And again, in the astrology apprenticeship program this past summer, I had year two students look at one chart and write out, using everything they've learned to this point, what they've learned about house one, house two, house three, house four, and all of the planets, write it all out individually, and then synthesize it together. And it was a wonderful exercise because one woman in particular, she kept focusing on these really positive karmas in the 10th house, dealing with career and types of career. But in her little description of the person, she kept saying, but this didn't actually happen that way. And it was a very strong, prominent Mercury-Venus combination, usually gives a lot of strength to career. Venus was doing very well in its own home, and Mercury is doing very well with Venus. And she was sort of fixated on that. I said, well, just go through all the houses first and see what happens. And what she discovered, which was beautiful the way she wrote it out, she was seeing how the second house functioned, how the sixth house functioned, how the person's emotional state and personality functioned, and how the chart itself could not support that wonderful karma necessarily in the 10th house, because all these other things weren't there as a foundation for it. And I told her, I said, look, don't be confused about this experience. I'm like, you just learned a really powerful principle of astrology, that it's not just, oh, look, you have a wonderful yoga in the 10th house with Mercury and Venus doing very well and good dignity. You also have to look to see, does the rest of the chart support that? And it didn't, which is why it didn't manifest in the fashion that I think what I would consider a novice astrologer, they might jump on that and say, oh, well, you're going to have a wonderful experience with career, when it's not necessarily going to be so if the rest of the chart doesn't support it. So
right.
Strength of the karma is related to how many times do we see it in the chart? What is the nature of the karmic fruition? And does the entirety of the chart actually support that?
And when you say what is the nature of karmic fruition, you're talking about Adi Avashta?
Yeah, I'm talking about, yes, exactly. That's I use that. Go ahead.
And what's the nature of Mrityu Avashta?
So when we get in the older Avashtas, when we're getting into like Vridha and Mrityu Avashta, these are considered old and dead states. And the way I typically see them working out is the person has maybe put a lot of time and attention towards this karma in past lifetimes, and it's going to be there. It's going to be something in their experience, but it's going to be something maybe not as prominent, or something they don't necessarily experience with full force. And the way I described that to one student who recently asked, I said, it's like when I was in high school and all I could listen to was Led Zeppelin, and I had the whole catalog memorized back and forth. That was a Yuva Avashta, and that's all I listened to. That was a prominent adult state. But now being older, I have that experience. I know every Led Zeppelin song front to back. I can even play most of them on guitar. But since I'm older now, it's there, but I don't listen to it every day. It's not fully in my awareness. It's more where a person will have potentially, depending on the dignity, greater wisdom about it. But it's an old karma. It's something that has gone through its life cycle. It's there in the person's consciousness, their wisdom, their experience, but it may not necessarily be something that's fully in their experience, awareness, and in their face right now. Mm.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I have two more questions related to this, which is interesting. The conversation never really went this way in other interviews, but as I said, I just like your systematic approach to things, and I feel like I can relate to it. Mm-hmm. So I guess I'm going to talk more about astrological techniques with you. But
yeah, okay.
One of them is philosophical. But this one immediately on my mind was, if you see a person with some dridha karma, like it's everything in the chart is saying that this is going to happen to the person and something negative, what's your method of counseling that person?
Well, that's hard. And I typically refer to a counselor. And the reason that's the case, and I think you bring up a very wonderful point about astrology, is that everyone typically, many people who get into astrology just assume that they can counsel people. And even I've spent a lot of time in the natural health field. I got my degree in psychology and philosophy. I've thought a lot about working with people and coaching people, and I've put a lot of time and attention to it. And even with all those tools that I particularly have, I have difficulty helping people change more fixed karmas. And that's because, in my experience, to do that, it requires very consistent time and attention. Mm. And what most people want when they come to an astrologer is they want their hour and a half, their 2 hour, 3 hour, whatever it is, period of time. And then after that, they want to say, okay, now I have all of this information, so I should be able to change it all. When really, a person needs to work with someone who has a background in understanding how people change and how to make positive changes. And that may take years. And many people don't necessarily want to invest in that. I mean, personally, I got into astrology, psychology, philosophy, meditation, because I wanted to change. And there are things that I've been working on for the past 20 years that I'm still trying to adjust and change. And it takes that kind of commitment. So I think what I typically do is if I see something like that and the person really truly wants to change, I explain to them the strength of the karma. I tell them, you know, this is something that's rather fixed. To change it, it's probably going to be very painful. You probably are going to be so identified with it, even if it's a bad thing, that you have difficulty. Like trying to tell someone who's been eating mashed potatoes and drinking Coke for 50 years that, you know, they have to change their diet in order to prevent diabetes. Some people, yes, usually very strong pitta types will say, I get it. I'll make that change right now. But most people, they have a lot of emotional baggage to go through. They eat that way for a particular reason that you have to really work with them consistently. So to be very honest, I rarely find individuals that want to commit the time that it's going to take to it. And sometimes I am willing to work with them in that regard. But most of the time I refer them to books like, there's a book called The Presence Process by Michael Brown, which is a wonderful book that allows a person to get back into the reasons why they might be making the choices, not astrologically, just getting into why does a person feel anxiety all the time? Well, it takes you back through childhood and it takes you back through all these experiences that might have contributed to it to resolve it. There's another book by Dr. Joe Dispenza called Breaking the Habit of Being You. And I found it to be a wonderful book because I remember there's a show called The 70 Show, a comedy, a really great show. And I remember one of the main characters in that show said to another character one time, he said, look, there's nothing wrong with you that changing yourself completely wouldn't fix. And I remembered that and it always stuck with me. And I used it when I would teach my yoga and meditation classes. And then I got that book, Breaking the Habit of Being You. And it synthesized how to do that, that you really have to go through a process to change that. So I don't think that is an astrological thing. I do think astrological remedies can help, but I think that's also another topic in that I don't necessarily look at astrological remedies as magical things that are just going to, if you do the right number of mantras, it's just going to shift and change. I see gemstones. I mean, I don't have mine on this morning because I just got up, but I wear gemstones. I use mantras. I do yagyas. I do all these things, but I personally don't do them with the idea that just by doing them, they're going to magically change myself and my consciousness. I use them as reminders. I use them as focal points to help me continue to be that new state that I want to be in. So if I'm wearing a gemstone to help with my health, well, I'm going to use it for my health. I'm going to have it in my mind, know that it's conditioning my consciousness, but I'm also going to, every time I see it, remember, you know, don't eat a lot of garlic or potatoes. Yeah. For me, it's garlic because I have a sensitivity to garlic, but don't eat a lot of potatoes where I look at it and I'll think to myself, okay, well maybe I should go for a run today. So every time I see that gemstone that's specific to health, I let it direct my attention to doing something that changes me to better health or to think differently. So in my mind, while I think that there are some strong esoteric powers to these gemstones, working with thousands of people, having people reach out to me for gemstones, for mantras, seeing that the people who get the best changes are those that don't just say, oh, look, I bought a $3,000 blue sapphire, so therefore everything's going to be better. People say, I bought the sapphire, and since I invested so much money in that, I want to make sure that I'm also doing things to support the situation. So I don't know if this is what you were getting at, but
I like it. I would say that actually, the so-called astrological remedies are not astrological remedies. They're also psychological remedies. It's a mantra. It has nothing to do with a planet. And these mantras scarcely even mention the names of the planets if you use the classical ones. And yagyas, what is that? It's not astrological. So that's also therapeutic, just like anything else, modern thing that you might come up with. Okay, I have another question for you. I recently learned that in the old Mesopotamian philosophy of
there's two. Is my microphone cutting out or doing anything?
No, new? I can hear you. Okay.
Okay. There's the original attitude towards it was that the omens were written in the sky to communicate things.
Now you're cutting out. Yeah, now I can't hear you. You were fine for there.
How's this? You can hear me.
I can hear you good. Yeah.
I'm going to switch.
I'm going to switch to this.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen,
technical difficulties. So, and the old astrologers used to say that this is like a message from the gods communicating some information to us that will help us. But mm-hmm. then around Ptolemy,
yeah,
he said, no, these are things that influence us. So what do you think? On what side of the fence are you on?
That's a tricky one. and the reason it's a tricky one is because, one of the things that always occurred to me, I'd always had this idea, this thought, that with astrology, we're using symbols, we're using myths, we're using metaphors to communicate some kind of information to individuals. And the reason this is difficult is because my main interest in life isn't necessarily astrology. I've always had a deep love for yoga and meditation. I began in Kriya Yoga, and then I fell in love with self-inquiry vichara with Ramana Maharshi, and that led me to Vasistha's Yoga. And all these texts really, or not texts, all these philosophies lead to this idea that everything is a representation of the mind. Whether it's your little mind that you consider to be the little you, the little Ryan, or the little Vic, but that's also just a little fragment of the cosmic mind or the bigger consciousness. And this kind of brings us down to a fundamental principle of just human nature in general, that when you don't understand something, you typically ascribe to it these sort of superstitious properties. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, because we are all somewhere in consciousness. And so the person who has a strong, devoted faith in Jesus, and they go and they pray to Jesus and they use that power, and by attuning to that idea, they're able to shift their mind and consciousness. That's no different than the person who reads, for example, Vasistha's Yoga, and realizes, oh, well, this is all mind stuff, so I just have to change my mind. It's still, what is being accomplished is still being accomplished. It's just, a different way of thinking about it. So when I cognize this, my main focus is that when you're talking to a dreamer, you have to speak in the language of dreams. I've always said that. That's been something that just came to me one day, and I try to, instill that in my students. And so if someone comes to me and they're, really interested in understanding the gods and the goddesses and the powers of consciousness in that regard, or they're really interested in anthropomorphism, seeing the planets with human personalities and so on, why speak in that way? Because I know that's how they're going to get the most benefit, because that's where they are in consciousness. So in my mind, when I think about, what's going on here, is this the gods communicating with us, or is it just the simple nature that things happen, and when things happen, they influence something else? Well, it depends on who I'm talking to. And the other day, it also occurred to me, when we think about what I consider to be real Vedic religion and spirituality, it was very much nature-based. They worshipped lightning, storms. They worshipped water, the oceans. All these things which were very present in their awareness in that age. And I think that it's very important to remember that all these things have an influence on us, because they are also a part of us. So whether we say, the ocean, we use whatever kind of Sanskrit words we want to define the ocean, and we give reverence to it, it's not the point that we use a Sanskrit name or word to define that as ocean. That's not what gives it the holiness to the ocean or to the water. It's that we're able to connect with, be with, understand what that ocean is, what it represents in relationship to us. And, it's like when you go out and you are at the ocean, at the beach, and you see the moon rising, and you're in awe of the power of the moon and how it just affects your consciousness, how it brings a sense of coolness and peace and clarity to you. Well, what a lot of people do is they say, oh, well, let's get out some flowers and incense and chant to that moon. Well, that's helpful if it helps them direct their attention towards the power of the moon. But why do all that? The moon is there. It's right there. You don't have to do anything to call it into your awareness. It's fully connecting with it. So I think that when we look at astrological influences, what we need to realize is that they are aspects of our own consciousness. And if we need tools like words or ideas or, you know, certain concepts to connect with it, to understand it, well, that's just the language of dreams that we happen to need to be speaking right now. But we don't necessarily need those things. We can simply realize that they're parts of us. And this comes down to a very important part of astrology. You mentioned omens. Well, what are omens? Omens are things that help us understand maybe the answer to our questions or what's happening right now. But there are millions and billions of things happening all at once. Even right now, even, you know, me sitting in this room, you sitting wherever you are, you know, I'm looking out this window here, I see trees, I hear birds. So there are these millions and billions of things going on, even internally myself, that if someone comes and asks me a question, as an astrologer, sure, I can use the chart to see what's going on, or I can pay attention to what my awareness is drawn to. And that's going to give me an insight into what the answer to that question is. But the question is, why was I drawn to that one thing when there are all these millions of other things that I could have been drawn to? It's because it's that aspect of consciousness that relates to the question being answered. And that's why when a person asks a question of an astrologer and they pull up the chart, what the astrologer at that moment sees within the chart, that relates to that question, because that is a specific thing that their consciousness, the bigger consciousness, is going to find the answer, the information in. But that's just 1 billionth or 1 trillionth of the whole possible things we could pay attention to. So there's something greater that directs us to these specific things. What that is, we can't really talk about, but it is a principle that kind of drives astrology. And I think it's an important one to remember that it can't all be mechanical in that way, like we talked about a little earlier.
That was good. I'm trying to wrap my head around it. So,
well, hopefully I didn't talk in the circles. I hate it when I do that.
No, that's what I like. You talking straight lines. That's what I like.
Okay, good.
Yeah, but let me see if I can grab what you're saying in relation to what my question was.
Yeah, so, let's get back to that.
So I think what I definitely related to right away was you have to speak in the language of dreams when you're talking to a dreamer. So it just is very handy and kind of accurate and useful to describe the planets as if they're doing something when interpreting them, because that's the symbolism. But in actual fact of the matter, they're not doing something. Mm-hmm. They're not separate entities from us doing something to us. They represent symbolically aspects of our own consciousness, you're saying. Exactly. And they're the reason why this whole scheme exists in the first place. Would you agree with this? It was because of this super consciousness wanting to be able to direct information to us?
Yeah, and really it's a conversation with ourselves. You know, that's the key there. And, you know, this also answers that fundamental question that everyone asks, you know, well, why is it that, you know, Western astrologers that, you know, there can be a Western astrologer that, you know, thousands of people go to and thousands of people say, wow, you know, they really spoke to my needs. Or here's a tropical astrologer that uses Vedic techniques. Wow, they really spoke to my needs. They're right. The proof is in their pudding, you know, or the sidereal astrologer, the same thing. Why is it that we have all these people that you can say the same thing about? They're just so wonderful. They know everything. Well, why is it that that's the case? It's because that there is a consciousness, and we all, you know, kind of roam in a sphere of certain consciousness. You know, that's why I think Kriya Yoga and Vichara is the most best spiritual practice there is, you know.
Bestest.
People can have different ways of seeing things, and they also get good results with it. It's because my consciousness, other people's consciousness, they need information. There's certain ways of gaining knowledge. And when a certain type of knowledge is needed, they will be drawn to the type of individual who, whether or not they're right in regards to the actual physical things that are going on, that person will speak to, interpret the person's life in a way that is right for them. And that's why, astrologically, the best thing anyone can do to get an astrological technique is not finding the best astrologer. It's meditating, clearing one's consciousness, and having the understanding that they can get good information, because then they're clearing the way within their own consciousness so that whoever they talk to, that person is going to say something to them that is profoundly helpful. So this is difficult for me to say, because on one hand, you know, it really brings responsibility not only to the astrologer, but to the client. But the client themselves has to be in a place to receive good knowledge. That's like think about it. Think about teenagers who, I was thinking about writing an article on this called The Wise Child and the Worldly Child, where you have the wise child who has the parent who says, look, if you want to be successful, do this. And the wise child says, oh, okay, you know, I trust you. I've got good rapport, good karma to get good information. So I'm not going to go out and make all these thousands of mistakes that I would otherwise. I'm just going to listen to what you say, trust you, and move forward through my life and do well. We're going to consider that to be the wise child. Then there's going to be the worldly child who doesn't have karma to just simply hear information from someone who knows and make those choices. They have to learn through making mistakes. They have to go out in the world and they have to, you know, hurt themselves and stumble and pick themselves back up. And then by the time they're 60 or 70, well, now they're wise because they went through all that crap. And so they're going to see these hundreds of thousands of people coming to them for knowledge and information. And they're going to say, look, I've got all this wisdom. I've got all this experience. Some of you are going to benefit from it and some of you aren't. And that's due to the fact that some of you have an inner state of clarity that allows you to hear that wisdom and act upon it. So the best thing anyone can do when it comes to astrology, number one, the client needs to focus on, I have the capacity to hear what needs to be heard so that I can live my life better or more clearly. They have to get really clear on that so that they feel it truly within their heart. That's step number one. And then they have to listen, of course, to what's told to them. But what I even tell my astrological apprenticeship students, I say, look, all these techniques that we go through, they're wonderful. And I think that by applying them, you're going to be head and shoulders above many other people who might be, you know, more simple or less logical in their approach. Again, that's just me being judgmental, but that's what I say. But I tell them that beyond that, the best thing you can do is every day meditate and confirm and meditate until you get to the point to where you know that whoever you're working with, you have the capacity to share with them the best and clearest information possible. And once you get in that state and you can trust in that, then you will be guided to say those things to the individuals that are most important for them, that will actually help them in the long run. So astrology aside, that's more the outer covering. The inner stuff, which is the inner consciousness, is actually getting into that state, realizing that it's not about Saturn is doing this to you or Jupiter is doing this to you. It's that your consciousness is colored or triggered in such a way that you respond to this kind of aspect, this quality of yourself, that you keep making these choices. So if you actually develop the planet itself and you try to live with it in its highest fashion, all you're really doing is living with the fullness of yourself in its highest fashion too, just sort of projected out into this idea of the planets.
That's so great.
Does that answer your question?
And more.
Okay.
Yeah, I liked it. Okay, now I was thinking about the rest of the questions, but you know, I was wondering, would you be upset if I veer off course? Or like, did you prepare answers for these other questions?
I didn't actually. I looked at them when you sent them to me and I thought, you know, did he save all these easy questions for me?
Sarcastic, those are all hard questions, right?
Yeah. But then I decided after that, I'm just going to go with whatever, you know, whatever comes up.
Well, how about we'll do these questions really fast? Give me short answers. That makes it even harder, right?
Yeah.
Okay. What's happiness?
What is happiness? I would say happiness is being okay with whatever happens.
Nice. And what about suffering?
Suffering. Well, I don't know if I can give a quick answer for that one. I think there are a couple different things to know about suffering, so I'll do my best to keep it short. Okay. Number one, I think on a very basic level, suffering can simply be an energy of contrast, in the sense that if you want to go in a certain direction and you meet with a wall and you run into that wall, you hit it and you experience pain, you experience suffering. Mm. And so if you were more conscious, maybe you could have missed that wall and gone around it. But what it typically does is it gives us a sense of, if I'm moving in a direction and I hit something painful, I need to reevaluate and see how I can go around it. So that's a very basic way. Suffering is also character building. And I think many people miss that. You know, to become an adult in this world, learning to deal with suffering and learning to see its place in life is very important. You know, we have all these planets and some of them cause suffering because they're also a part of ourself. That's one way. The other thing I think is that suffering is simply a misunderstanding of the wholeness of life, because, you know, life renews itself. In order for it to renew itself, sometimes things have to be lost or sometimes things have to be changed. So we attach, when we get attached to something, we experience suffering. Really, if we were able to draw back to a higher perspective, we might see that suffering is simply like the shade in a painting. You know, it's required to give depth. But if all we have is this myopic view that all we look at is the black part in the painting, well, that's all we see. We don't appreciate the fact that it's creating this larger tapestry. So that's my simple answer for what is suffering.
That's great. Okay, great. So you said happiness is to be okay with whatever happens.
Yeah.
Suffering is to like really want something and then run up against the wall when you can't get to it. But the good parts of it is that it will build your character. It has a role, right?
Yes, hopefully. I mean, some suffering can be so destructive that it's really hard to bear. But the idea is that it allows you to have a greater sense of maybe compassion for humanity,
I think. Yeah, yeah. Okay, great. Now, how about love? What's love, Ryan?
Okay. So right now, when you are, you know, paying attention to what we're discussing, when we're engaged in this, are you listening quietly in your mind, fully present, or are you thinking about the next thing to say?
Mostly I'm listening. Time to time, I'm thinking about what's going to come next.
Okay. Well, the time that you are fully present, that is love.
Yeah. I actually understand what you're saying. I like that.
Yeah. And I did think about that question a little bit. I was going for a walk the other day, and I was walking by a stream, and I was walking between these beautiful trees and watching the light on the water. And I realized, you know, I think I know what he wants to get at, but really, you know, for me, that is love. Because when you're fully present and you can appreciate what's there, what's around you, so walking by a stream on a summer morning can be love. That experience of quiet, that experience of clarity, when that is there, and that can be there in any kind of situation. That can be there in passion. That can be there in just eating dinner with, you know, your spouse. That can be there working. But it's that state of presence that I think is the actual real definition of love.
I like it. I totally relate with it. Now, there's a song for that too, right? There's "What is love anyway," right? And then there's another song is "Let's talk about sex, baby."
Right.
So what's the relationship between love and sex?
I mean, I think there can be one, but you know, that's always an interesting thing, especially in the astrological community when people are obsessed with the eighth house. And so personally, I think that the idea of sex is just simply a natural act of procreation. I think that's it. You know, I mean, we don't go out and glorify the wonderful feeling we have when we have a great bowel movement. I mean, some people do, right? But that's something that I think, because sex is such a powerful physical experience of hitting that point of no thought, of full presence,
right?
That we attribute it to having greater emphasis than I think it needs, because it's the attachment to sex. It's, you know, all the things that come with sexuality that cause a lot of problems within our world. And I know this is not going to be a popular thing. People are going to say, well, what about Tantra? What about, you know, all these different things? That's all just, it's all just another form of entertainment. And there's a book called, I think it's called Agora or Agori.
Yeah.
Anyway, Robert Sobota. And this is about a yogi who's on the left-hand path. And there are instances in there where he talks about training that involves sex. And it's not about, you know, going out and, you know, having this wild, passionate, mind-blowing sex. You know, it's about sitting there with a naked person who is utterly beautiful and being in complete control and not having any desire to do anything about it, just to be there and be completely calm and peaceful and cool inside, not be driven by one's passions. So I think it's wonderful when you can have an experience with someone that you are fully present, you are caring, you are with them, you are in a dance. I look at it like a dance or music. If you can experience a dance and music completely peacefully, completely passionately, calmly while having sex, that's wonderful. But ultimately, really, it's just something that you should be creating babies with.
So that's the second point in which you're a lot like Joni Petrie.
Oh yeah.
The first point is Led Zeppelin. Did you know that she was into Led Zeppelin?
No. All right.
That's a mind blower, right?
Yeah.
She revealed this in my interview. She's into Led Zeppelin. And then the other one that was her opinion about sex too, believe it. She was just really flat about it and said, and she said some things about it like it's just mostly the way people try to control other people.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah. And that's a very, you know, one of the people I really like listening to and contemplating is Jiddu Krishnamurti. And so I sort of thought about, you know, his views on sex, and he goes on the exact same thing. He says, well, you know, what are you talking about when you talk about sex? Are you talking about that need to control and manipulate others so that you feel safe and comfortable? You know, and that's often what it is. And I do want to be clear that I have absolutely no problem enjoying sex, and I think it's wonderful to enjoy sex, but I think it's all the overemphasis on it that, you know, drains our life force and confuses us, and that's really the major problem with it, I think.
Good. That's a pretty yogic opinion also. Let's see. What about the self? I haven't asked anybody this question yet. It's always been like the last question on the list.
Okay.
But how about this? Astrology, the whole thing is I want to, at least most of the time, the way I think of it is I want to better understand who I am.
Yeah. And,
right. So, but who am I? What is the self?
Right. Well, that is something that no words can actually do justice to. And, you know, that's something that I loved about Vasistha's yoga, because the main focus of this text is obviously realizing the self. And what it always boils down to is, you know, the book is this thick. It's, you know, over 900 pages, and that's the abridged edition. And every time it keeps coming back to this idea that the self is simply what is. It's simply what is. And what most people do is they're just caught up in the idea that the self is what is something other than what they are. Because, and this all comes down to the idea of all the psychological problems that people have. Because if you didn't have any psychological problems, you wouldn't care about the self. You wouldn't even care about religion. You wouldn't have questions about God. You would simply be existing. You would be interacting with the world, and the world would be interacting with you, and that would be fine. It would be just this consistent continuum of experience. And so the idea, the self is simply an idea. And that's why Ramana Maharshi always says, well, find out who's asking that question. Because if you continue to contemplate and wonder, well, what is this self? Eventually you get to the point where you're thinking or feeling, well, what is even asking that question? And once you are able to stop asking questions and simply exist, without thought, without wondering, you lose concepts. And when you lose concepts, you experience the self. And when that occurs, again, since it's beyond concepts, it's something that you cannot talk about. So my easy definition for what is the self, it's everything. It's who you think you are. It's the sense of being in existence. But it's also that moment when you have absolutely no definition of who you are. And this is like a wave where you've got the crest and the trough. Sometimes you're up at the crest of the wave and you feel like you are someone doing something. Sometimes you're down at the trough where you're utterly oblivious and you're simply in the moment. And you know, you're a musician, you know, when you've had those experiences, and not even just music, but also in meditation, where you're playing and there is no you. There is no thought. There is no, what is the drummer doing? What is the bass player doing? There is just this flow of melody, this flow of rhythm, this dance that's going on, and it's happening without anything, any thought, nothing. It's just happening. That is a direct experience, what I would consider a direct experience of the self beyond concepts. So there's the conceptual self, Vic, Ryan, I like green tea, I don't like garlic. There's the non-conceptual self, which is simply when you are there and there is no definitions occurring in your mind. And the reason we can't speak about that is because only direct experience can reveal it to you, because the mind can only go so far. But through meditation, through music, through dance, through sex even, when you hit that point of being and there's no driving force, there's no defining factors, that is the eternal self. So conceptual, non-conceptual, impermanent, eternal. But again, they're just sides of the same thing. You know, you can't have one without the other, right? You can't have, and I could go on and on. I don't want to keep, I think you get the point.
you could go on a little bit, but you know, I just wanted to say, you know what I wanted to say?
What?
I like green tea and I don't like garlic too.
Right. So our conceptual selves agree.
In alignment. We're in alignment.
Yeah.
Can I ask you for your lagna?
Virgo.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, okay, that's a nice your Earth sign. It's
you were surprised.
Trying to mind. I thought maybe it was Capricorn.
No, Virgo for sure. Yeah, I do have Saturn, so that's probably where that comes across.
Yeah,
and this probably gives it away, huh?
So. Yeah, that's kind of making me bold enough to ask you a question. No, because I think we're kind of aligned. This is something about us.
That's right. You're Capricorn, right?
Yeah, it's easy to hear what you're saying and figure out.
Well, you know, if you're Capricorn, then we're
trying to, right?
We're trying from each other, so that makes it good.
And if you're a Virgo with Saturn in it, you know, I'm also kind of similar. I'm Capricorn with Saturn in Taurus.
Okay. So yeah, so we get another trine to Saturn there.
Yeah, and we get another, we got Saturns in Earth signs, earthy Saturns.
Yeah.
All right, Ryan, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Anything else you want to say?
Well, I don't know. You want to talk more about technique things, so.
No, I don't like to do interviews for too long, too.
Okay.
Yeah. What else do I want to say? What I want to say is, I think everybody knows you, but I'm going to put links, of course, to your site. Is there anything that you want to say, like some new book or anything that you're selling?
No, I've got a few books in the works, but the past 2 years, I seem to have started, you know, 5 or 6 books, and they're all just kind of happening on their own. So hopefully when Saturn moves here in January, then that'll get cranking a little bit more. But the only thing I would say that I have been having a lot of fun with the Astrological Apprenticeship Program. And I have to say that of all my work, this is the most enjoyable because, you know, what we're doing is we're starting at the very beginning and we're building up this logical approach to astrology. And I love it because when you start to see, you know, as you experience how to put things together logically, for example, people look at different aspects like Rashi aspects, planetary aspects, and the Tajik aspects, and sometimes they use them redundantly. And they're all meant to have something specific that they're meant to deal with. Or people look at different avashtas and they use them redundantly. Or there's many things in astrology that can seem redundant, you know, like Ishta and Kashta and Dignity and Shadbala. Like, well, what are we using there? But one of the things I'm enjoying doing is working with these students to show them the specific facet that each aspect of astrology fits to. And so to get to my point, these start at the beginning of every year. So we're going to have another one coming up. It's a 4-year program beginning in probably February of 2018. And so if anyone's interested, on my website at astralvedicastrology.com under the Astrology Apprenticeship Program, there's a whole list. There's even examples of students' papers because I require them to write at least in the first two years, 1,500 word papers per class. And so I've got examples of those up there. And anyway, I'm enjoying teaching this because I'm starting to see people learn astrology in what I consider to be a logical, methodical manner. And I want to promote more of that.
Yeah. So
that's the only thing I would like to
throw. Yeah. I would like to see that too. I would like to do that.
You probably already have a pretty good handle on it.
I have a handle, but you can always get a better handle. And it's always nice to see how other people do things. But my only problem is time.
Yeah.
If I had time, I would totally be there myself.
Yeah, I want to take Chris Brennan's course.
Yes.
Yeah.
His book is very good.
Yes, I read his book too. And you got to the interview first. Everything that you talked about, I was going to talk about with him. But he has a great course on Hellenistic astrology. And I kept looking, and I was like, man, I would love to do that after reading this book.
Yeah.
But the same thing, it's like, 90 hours? One of these days we'll get around to it.
Well, but I only interviewed him on the first 3 chapters. You can interview him on the later chapters. Yeah.
Still, you hit all the things I wanted to get at. So
I'll
have to read a little bit deeper.
That's one thing that I am. I'm fast about things.
Yeah, that's right.
All right, Ryan, sorry about that.
That's okay.
Okay, everybody, please say thank you to Ryan.
Take care.
Thank you so much.
Peace.